Harper and Harper Audio present Kindling by Traci Chee. Performed by Catherine Ho, Jeanne Syquia, Amielynn Abellera, Allison Hiroto, Erika Ishii, Joy Osmanski, and Ferdelle Capistrano. For the young who fight for us all. Part 1. The Restless. Liam. The war took you many places on the Kindar Peninsula, and in the years since the war ended, you've pretty much seen the rest. But you've never been to the Northlands until now. Too remote. Nothing up here but rocks and cattle. Cow pies and dust. It's a harsh land, without a doubt. But that's why it appeals to you. The ruggedness of it. The relentlessness of it. The plains rising and falling like waves while the wind howls across the countryside. Pine, sage, rabbit brush, stone. The sun blazing. The heat rising from the road. A few days in the high desert, and you're parched and sunburned, with new holes in the soles of your sandals. Though, to be fair, they were already wearing thin weeks ago when you set off for the north. But you're almost there now, almost to the mountains. The mighty Candaveras, where the Kindar Peninsula kisses the continent. And the nation of Amarand ends. Ahead of you, that vast and jagged border looms, sharp, immense, severe. The fortresses of gods, or the gods themselves, at the tail end of summer and still capped with snow. The Candaveras are all that stand between you and the kingdom of Ifrin beyond. The rest of the world beyond. You pause. You kneel. Scratch your dog behind the ears and adjust the tiny silver medal you wear around your neck. If you had to take one last look at your country, you couldn't ask for a better view than this. The Kindar Peninsula had been tearing itself to pieces long before you entered the war. Amarand and Vedra, north and south. For 100 years, those titans raged back and forth on the fields, the beaches, the steep mountain slopes. The flash of steel. The sound of the drums. And us. Kindlings. A force of elite, magic-wielding warriors, pink flames rippling from our Baylor weapons as we carved great swaths through the ranks of our enemies. We fought for Amarand. We fought for Vedra. For 100 years, we were swept up in 2 violent, inexorable tides, ebbing and expanding, swallowing cities, villages, outposts. You can still remember how it felt, fighting on the vanguard. There, in the thick of it, with a squad of your kin. The weight of your armor. The give of the earth. The magic sparking wildly inside of you and rushing out through your blade. But it's been 2 years since you conjured fire from your fingers. 2 years since Amarand won the war. The Vedran royalty slipping quietly into exile. All the old maps redrawn. As a testament to the great and harmonious reunification, the Queen Commander, long may she reign, outlawed magic on the entire Kindar Peninsula, deemed it too cruel, too inhumane, unthinkable in peacetime. No more child soldiers. No more kids burning out by 18. And the ones who remained? The ones who survived? We were given a choice. Surrender our Baylor weapons for land and a stipend, or be turned loose, to live and fight and be put down if we ever dared to disturb the new and uneasy peace. Now you wear your sword across your back, for you no longer need it at your side. A less sentimental person would have sold it already, but you were always a sap, weren't you? Splitting your rations with the replacements, filching a few apples or an extra blanket for the orphans who dogged our convoys, begging for scraps. We gave you a hard time about it, but let's be honest. We all had a soft spot for orphans. For kids made homeless by war. If you were smart, you'd sell it. Crossing the Candavaris will lead you deep into the wilderness, or so you've heard. And that means provisions, pack animals, a guide. Since the war ended, you've already sold off most of your armor. First, the sabatons. Then the shin guards. The metal skirt that at one time protected you from the blades of your enemies. The cuirass. The shoulder plates. Your helmet, dinged from use. All you've got left are your sword, your gauntlets, and a handful of copper kidam that won't even buy a meal for you and your dog, much less the supplies for the journey. No stops between the Northlands and the outer settlements of Ifrin. To be fair, you didn't want a dog in the first place, and certainly not a speckled mutt with one half-chewed ear. But we don't always get to choose our companions, do we? Sometimes we just find them. Or they find us, clinging to us like sap on our shoe soles. Sticky and warm. You told yourself you didn't want a dog, didn't want attachments, not now, especially not now. Not after your brother Zan, not your brother by blood, but your brother in all the other ways that matter. Shoved you into the street and told you to leave him. It's none of your business, Liam. Get out of here, Liam. There's nothing for you here. He cried a little then. And that shook you. You'd never seen him cry before, not in all your months together. 11 months together. 11 months on the vanguard together. Until the official Vadrin surrender. You or he or both of you should have been killed or at least wounded seriously enough to be taken off the line. But you weren't. Inexplicably, incredibly, you weren't. Had so much time together. So many furious days in the mud and the dust. Your whole squad spattered in blood and stinking of sweat. Sometimes, when it was quiet, you'd lie around your campfire, saying nothing, staring up at the stars. 11 months together. For us, a miracle of time. He told you to leave, so you left him. And as you skulked out of the compound, the dog followed. Some stray the smugglers fed from the back door of their kitchens, hungry and flea-bitten. A little like you, come to think of it. Both skinny, scruffy, and liable to bite. You tried to ignore her as you made camp for the night, her bright eyes and snuffling breath just outside the ring of the firelight. You yelled at her. You told her to run. You tried to drive her away, but it didn't matter how much you shouted or how many stones you threw, not to hit her, just to scare her. And eventually, you let her lick the dinner off your fingers. Her tongue warm. Her fur oily under your palm. You fed her the last scraps from your bowl and laid down for the night. Angry and heartsick. And when you awoke in the morning, she was still there. A few days later, after you'd accepted that Zan was right, that there was nothing left for you in Amarand, you grew tired of chasing her off. You decided to call her Burke, which isn't a name we would have chosen, but hey, we're dead, and the dead don't get to have opinions. And you allowed her to stay. Shortly before noon, you and Burke come to a town at the base of the mountains. Windfall, according to the only trader you saw on the road this morning. It's an auspicious name for an inauspicious-looking place. A collection of rickety wooden buildings topped with thatched roofs and smoking stovepipes, everything looking likely to collapse in the next good rainstorm. If they get rainstorms up here. Of course they get rainstorms up here. Until then, the land's cracked with drought, the creek running through the square going dry in the heat. Angrily, you glower up at the searing alpine sun, which, undeterred, glowers back. Apparently unaffected by the heat, Burke trots ahead of you, sniffing at empty rain barrels and saloon stoops where itinerants lounge under the awnings, waiting for dark. In the center of the square, she finds a few merchants from Ifrin, conspicuous with their pale faces and high-bridged noses. You've seen Ifriners before, but you can't help but stare. Near the end of the war, you watched a convoy of them escort a delivery of hand cannons to the regiment your squad was attached to at the time. A couple of weeks of training. A few hands and feet blown off. And every wet-eared grunt became as lethal as one of us. Cheaper, too. An ordinary soldier with a hand cannon didn't need 7 years of training, didn't need one of those rare and expensive Baylor crystals. Just pop a weapon into their hands and point them at the enemy. Boom. These Ifriners aren't military, though. They're just civilians, bloody and beaten, their carts robbed of whatever it was they were carrying. Whoever attacked them must have been ruthless. Among the Ifriner's injuries, you spy a shattered ankle, a gaping eye socket, more lacerations and bruises than you can count. In the shade of an empty cart, one of the men is weeping openly beside a dead body, covered by a dirty sheet. You glance toward the Candavaris. You'd heard there were bandits in the mountains, but you didn't know they'd be as brutal as this. And this is supposed to be peacetime? Burke bounds over to the traders, docked tail wagging, but before she can reach them, one of the Ifriners lets out a cry, shooing her away with his large white hands. "We have nothing!" he shouts in his accented Kindarian. "It has all been taken! There is nothing here for you!" "Hey!" You stalk up to him. Hardly a menacing sight, you barely come up to his armpits. "Leave my dog alone." He eyes you dubiously through his bruises. "Let's face it, you're not much to look at. Never have been. You're small. You're grubby. Your robe, frayed. Your belt, tied in the feminine style. Stained. Your topknot, which should have signaled that you're a warrior, is currently a mess, overgrown locks falling around your wind-burned cheeks. "We have nothing," he repeats. "Raiders?" He nods. You know you shouldn't ask. It's none of your business, really. But you can't help yourself. Compassion, duty, valor, honor. Protect the weak, defend the defenseless. You used to have a code. Once. "When?" you ask. He shakes his head. "This morning." "Did they have hand cannons?" At your line of questioning, his gaze darts to the sword on your back. During the war, every kindling was given a weapon set with a Baylor crystal, that rare gem found only on the Kindar Peninsula, through which to channel their magic. Some of us got daggers, gauntlets, spears, shields. You got your sword. Since the war ended, you've taken to wrapping the hilt in linen so no one can see the Baylor crystal there. So no one will try to mug you for it. so no one will know what you are. Were. Used to be. The Afrinir may not have met any of us before, but in 100 years, we've become legends far beyond our borders. Kindarian fire soldiers. Young, ferocious, unrelenting. Given your age, only 16, your sword, your messy topknot. He must suspect. Why does it matter? He asks. Who are you to know?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.